WPTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.
New Arts Alive features the guest artists who will share their work for a better understanding of today's art. Program moderator is James Carroll. During the live presentation, the home viewer has the opportunity to call and speak directly with the artist. New Arts Alive is brought to you by the New Arts Program, a nonprofit arts service organization in cooperation with Berks Community Television. New Arts Alive is supported in part by the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, local government, area businesses, NAP memberships, and individual contributions.
Hello and welcome again to New Arts Alive. I am your host tonight. I'm Ron Schira, sitting in for James Carroll. And tonight we are going to be talking with Matt Mazurkiewicz, painter. And
that's me.
That's this guy over here. And he's he's got some unusual paintings that I really am interested in showing here. And I'm sure he is too.
I'm into that.
Yeah. But anyway, this is our flag. So we're in this election year. We figure that...
we're making Berks County great again.
Yes. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That wasn't copyrighted, was it?
No, it doesn't matter because Donald Trump probably stole it anyway.
Probably.
Yeah. So.
So here we are.
So here we are, and welcome.
Oh, I just broke the set. Good to see you, and good to see you all out there in TV land.
Yes. So we're going to talk about your artwork, and we have some images to show you, and
cool.
And we're going to have a little discussion here. And
Let's do it.
So what is? Tell us about yourself. Matt.
Myself personally? Well, let's see. I'm a Pisces. No. All right. I'm born and raised here in Redding, Berks County, since 1976. And went to school around here and eventually went off to college at the Pennsylvania School of Art and Design in Lancaster. Graduated there in 1997. Then I moved on to the School of Visual Arts in New York City in Manhattan and got some kind of degree there, BFA, that's it. Bachelor of Funk Arts or something, but anyway, that was in 2000, then I moved back to Reading in late 2001, and actually it was 2 weeks before 9/11, but that's irrelevant, but, and I'm an artist, I do graphic design to pay my bills and rent and all that stuff, but I've been painting for the better part of 30 years, so.
Yeah,
professionally, I don't know how long, because I don't know if I'm professional or not, but I don't know.
I think that's a point for discussion, too, is like what defines a professional.
I don't know.
You know, as far as being an artist and you know, being a painter, you're going to paint regardless whether
right.
you're making money out of it or not. And, well, that's the way I am. I paint, but I don't make any money. So
it's just something we have to do.
Yeah, it's just something you have to do. It's part of it's part of who you are. You know, I think it's part of your identity. Like you can't say that, you know, that I can turn it on or off. You know.
Yeah.
It's just that's what you are. So your particular kind of art, though, what is it about what you do that is that's different? I mean, yeah,
different than what? I don't know. I don't know. I mean, I don't know how to approach this question. What do I do that's different than anybody else? I don't know that I do anything much different. But I mean, right now I'm painting on found strange raw materials that I kind of happen
right.
upon when I'm foraging around the woods and
mm-hmm.
or just out and about.
So it's kind of what would you call it? An art of abject art. Say, for instance, it's
sure.
kind of using material, using materials that have either been thrown away or discarded or not even
forgotten about
or not even considered to be art materials. I mean, it could be like a piece of old torn linoleum that's sitting in a, you know, in a scrapyard somewhere. But you know, you've been using this these pieces of
stuff
and you've been painting on them, and the painting is also somewhat naive in appearance, maybe not in nature, because you're far from naive. You know your stuff, and I think you're very knowledgeable about art and all that. But it seems that your methodology involves a sort of sarcastic, maybe even ironic use of these materials to present an idea that is not in the mainstream, but it gets a across a poetic point, you know, a point where you can see. You kind of see a humor in it, and a commentary on society, et cetera, et cetera. There's, so I guess it's hard to say. It really is.
Yeah, I think that there's definitely a lot of humor. A lot of it's kind of might just be local humor, or just something I made up. Like I might just hear a phrase over someone else's conversation, and I want to extract that and use that little phrase, like, hey buddy, just strange things that you hear, in common areas and, folklore and all that stuff.
Yeah, and it's also kind of funny in a way. It's kind of like you hear this stuff and then you see it in this manner. It's almost like you're saying, this is like old, it's cliche, it's been used over and over again, and now you're saying something about it.
Yeah.
You know, and now it's now you've opted it into the public
repurposed.
Yeah.
That's a big catchword. Everybody likes repurposing.
Everybody likes repurposing.
It's the HGTV sorry, I didn't mean to mention that channel.
Oh,
you're gonna bleep that out. You know, it's very. I don't know. I guess I do see it as a sort of a repurposing of a thought or an idea or something I overheard. And everything happens really fast when I paint. And there was a time when I would labor over a single image or painting for months at a time, and it became too much about the process, and that can be a dangerous thing. You know, so there are a lot of successful visionary type people or artists that you'll see in art news and all that stuff that, that are successful with their method and their, what's the word I just used? The process.
The process,
And I got, it just got too much about that, and it lost the idea, the vision just kind of faded away, and I think I made some pretty okay stuff during that period of time, but in the past few years I've really been focusing on reactionary kind of work, something that happens relatively quick and is made with stuff that's close to me. I might grab one of my kids' crayons, and if something crosses my mind, and
anything you can make a mark with.
But I mean, you can thank ADHD for that in part, but most of the time it's just
Well, I do. I did notice that for quite a while. Some of your stuff. I think you said once upon a time that your kids would suggest something.
Yeah.
Yeah, like one of your boys would say, hey Dad, paint a dog or something like that.
I still rely on them to do that. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So in that way, your role as a father, comes into that too, because your kids are young yet.
Yeah.
Yeah. So and
7, 7, and 10. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So that's pretty cool, though. But I think, you know, I miss those days. My daughter is 26 now, so go ahead. Yeah. Well, anyhow, 25. But it's just that incorporates all of your life, you know, because you have, you know, your kids and, you know, your life itself. And then when you get out and see things, you know, you're influenced by it. I mean, maybe you see where I'm stumbling. So
no, that's fine. I hear where you're, what you're throwing down.
Uh-huh.
But yeah, I rely a lot on, you know, on chance and suggestions. You know, every week I ask one of my boys, you know, what should I make a painting of? And they'll think for a second and throw out something like, you know, a Pokemon on fire or something. and I'll try and make that reality.
Yeah.
But yeah.
Well, yeah, that's like nowadays, that's kind of like about what you would like to see as a Pokemon on fire.
But yeah, I still rely on them for suggestions, and you know, it kind of takes a lot of the, oh, I don't know, something out of the process. You know, I like it there being this kind of disconnect between, mm-hmm. you know, instead of like, okay, this week I'm gonna do a painting of a covered bridge in Ole. I just want it to be fast and spontaneous and reactionary and
you're part of life.
Yeah,
yeah, you also with people like Matt Deterrier,
yeah,
who's you know, a good friend of yours,
good guy.
It's bringing a different value to art. You know, it's like taking into consideration the raw, the grotesque, the, you know, the disaffected. You know, I mean, all of that stuff. It's all a new way of saying pretty much the same thing that the earlier groups were saying, you know, by painting images of the poor and
yeah.
oppressed and this and that. And this way, that discrepancy is actually shown in the materials and in the method, in the raw production of what you're doing.
Yeah.
So
yeah, I think that, you know, I think the raw, the grotesque, the turned over rocks turned over. I mean, everything is just as valid aesthetically as again a covered bridge or rainbow or
a rainbow
or known as Bed Bath and Beyond art.
Right. You know, pretty art. You know, you don't know. It's.
I'm dropping the names of a lot of corporations tonight. I hope this isn't gonna get me arrested or something like
that. No, it'll just be, you know, seen by dozens and dozens of people out there. So, well, anyway, should we like take a look at some of the work?
Sure.
Maybe it would be easier to talk about if we had something to look at.
Sure.
So, this first piece is called Sausage Mitts. Well, I'm assuming it's
that's
called
Sausage. That's we can call it that. I stopped giving titles. I like people making up their own. Uh-huh. But yeah, I like that. That was actually, that was actually a self-portrait. That was one of the most recent self-portraits I've done. I've always been made fun of about my hands just being like Polish coal miner sausage mitts, someone always said I had. So I wanted to do a painting based on that, and there it is. And that was the result of it, and that was actually a slab of wood that I found somewhere out near the Tulpehockin Creek.
Mm-hmm.
And that's just paint and charcoal and stuff on there.
What kind of paint are you using on that?
I'm using a combination of house paints, old house paints. I like going to Lowe's or Home Depot and finding out the returns, the little things that are like a dollar and that people, you know, didn't like how it turned out. Those make great cheap paints. But yeah, house paints and some acrylics that you buy at the box stores. But mm-hmm. there's also some charcoal in there, I think, maybe mm-hmm. to get some of those blacks. Actually, I think it was still wet when I took that picture, but you know.
That this black up on the top here, that almost looks like it's tar or some sort of sticky black substance.
Maybe it is. I don't know. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there might be some pieces in here. I would I've been going camping a lot lately, and I've been, after the fire kind of dies down, I scoop out a lot of the black ash and let that charcoal and just kind of dry out, and that stuff makes really good for drawing.
Oh, yeah.
It's very nice, rich black.
Yep.
Foraging for materials.
Very cool.
I forgot that I sent that one in.
Yeah. There's Pikachu, and he's ablaze.
Yeah. I won't lie, and hopefully I won't jeopardize my career. I did this actually on a break at work at one day, and yeah. I'll just leave it at that. But yeah, that's just an envelope that I kind of destroyed, and it was right at the beginning of the Pokemon craze. That's the only Pikachu I've ever drawn. So
Well, that's
and painting on bubble wrap is really not very fun.
Well, that's the bubble wrap is inside the package, right?
Yeah.
What you did is you carved out the shape of the Pokemon onto out of the envelope, you know, the padded envelope, and let the bubble wrap on the inside of it show through. It's interesting.
Yeah, I don't know what really else to say about that one. That's yeah. You can find me on Facebook and buy it from me.
Yeah,
cheap. Oh,
okay. Cheap, he says. Okay, now there's you did it. Okay.
I like that one. Yeah, that's one of my favorites. I always like birthday cake.
Mm-hmm.
Especially the cheaper the icing, the more grittier and cheap it is, the more delicious the cake is. But I don't know. I just wanted to make some sort of congratulatory type piece that really wasn't speaking to anyone directly, and that's kind of what came of it. I don't know. That's a pretty small one. I think that's maybe about 5 by 6 inches. And
So generally, you have been working pretty small though lately.
Yeah, that's what happens when you run out of room.
Yeah,
and you have a basement full of large pieces, and you know, flat little pieces of metal. Just kind of throw them in a drawer somewhere and find them later.
Well, I recall pieces that you've done that have been 8 foot by 6 foot. You know,
yeah,
some really massive works. And some of them extremely heavy that you needed two people to pick one up.
Yeah,
you know?
I have another piece that there might be a picture of in here that weighs about 70 pounds, I think, and it's on a chunk of metal that I found in Laureldale.
Oh my God, yep. For your consideration.
Yeah, that actually the only thing that I really touched on there was writing that, and I just I think that was it's a very strong trio of words, and I wanted it 4 times, and so I wrote it 4 times.
See, well, this is
like anti art.
Well, it is anti art, but at the same time, it's art because it talks about it's. What do they call it? Critique. It's institutional critique. You're critiquing art itself. So you're using art to critique art. Was it ekphrastic?
I like that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, yeah. So it's. I think that, you know, it's a good. It's a really good idea. It's the. It's the mystery of it, and it's the. I'm having trouble finding the correct word.
I'm not quite sure what it is you're supposed to be considering.
Yeah.
It's like, are you considering the piece itself or, you know,
something in you?
What's it about?
Something in yourself that, you know, that I'm not privy to.
Yeah, I don't like giving the answers to mysteries, you know. I like making the mystery. Yeah. Not unlike the Sarah McLachlan song.
It's all about the mystery.
I think that was Sarah McLachlan. I don't know.
The
mystery.
I don't.
Was that Sarah McLachlan?
I don't listen to Sarah McLachlan. I listen to her if she's there. You know.
Yeah.
You know, she's Sarah McLachlan. She's a good singer.
But yeah, this is a lot of what we're looking at is mostly on this found scraps of rust bark and scrap wood and. stuff that you I find out in my travels. I'm actually at the point where my 7-year-old is driving around. Well, he's not driving. He's being driven around and is looking at trash in front of people's house and saying, "Dad, I saw something that's really good to paint on." Mm. And that's good. So,
well, that's good. You got assistance.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's, I think it'd look better if he did it instead of me. I'm like driving around in my truck behind mini malls, strip malls, looking for stuff to paint on. That's actually at that point. So.
Mm-hmm. So, where do you show your work?
I think that the largest venue right now is on Facebook, and I'm making the stuff and photographing it while it's still wet sometimes, and that's a good venue to share things fast and get reactions to. I mean, I've sold about half a dozen paintings in the past 2 months just through Facebook alone, and that's been pretty successful. I mean, but most recently I've shown at Studio B out in Boyertown, which is a great little gallery.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And was part of a group show there and had a couple pieces there, and the doodle show as well. Some really great talents showing down there.
Oh yeah.
But
yeah,
I've shown at a couple places around here. So Goggle Works there.
You had a solo exhibit at the Goggle Works.
I did. 2011, I think it was. Mm-hmm. I filled up a couple thousand square feet of stuff. So space. Mm-hmm. Not stuff, but yeah, that was. It's been a while since I had a solo show.
Well, folks, can pick up on this guy.
Got to pay rent.
Yeah. Oh lordy. Oh, now this is different for you. This is like a roulette wheel.
Yeah, I think that's called a hex roulette. That's on a hubcap that I pulled out of somewhere down near the Schuylkill River in like Exeter, I think. But yeah, I've always been intrigued by local folklore, and especially, you know, Pennsylvania Dutch and Amish art and symbolism and all that stuff. And I was like, oh, I want to make up my own hex sign, which might be considered a dangerous thing to do. But I just did it on this hubcap and made a piece out of it, and it got shown. So I don't think anybody bought it. So that's awesome.
That was down in Studio B, right?
Yes, yeah, it was. Uh-huh.
So that was in that one show.
And that's essentially just a Sharpie on hubcap, no frills about it at all. It's just what it is. I didn't know what it would look like. I just kind of sat down and started it. I never really have a preconceived notion of what I'm doing.
Well, the neat thing about stuff like this and Pennsylvania German art is that it has almost a mandala type of reference. Like you can see the same thing, you know, in that art that you can in Buddhist or Hindu art.
Yeah.
So there's similarities, but you know that they didn't. They didn't cross-pollinate. They just came up out of the different cultures at different times. But images like that have an almost religious reference to it. You know, I see like you have birds and crowns there. Is that right?
Yeah, it's kind of like a strange bird. Like I think someone asked me at the opening if they were slugs. I think I probably said, yeah, sure, they're slugs.
Whatever you say. Whatever you want. You know, you're not picky.
No, not at all. But yeah, it was a fun piece to make for me.
It looks fun. And on top of that too, I think it would look great in a home somewhere.
I think it would too.
Yeah. Oh, by the way, I still have Jimmy on hanging on my wall at home.
Oh, good. Yeah. Good.
Yeah. I own a painting by this guy. Which I display proudly, by the way.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
Good. Is it behind glass?
Like yeah, it was a...
Lexan or something?
It's like a, you know... it was on Luan, and the... it's framed in a shadow box And at first, I didn't know what it was when you said it was Jimmy, but then when you said that it was actually a portrait of your old car.
Yeah, it was. I had a 1978 Ford pickup truck that was about 20 feet long, and I loved that truck. It took me all of 200 miles before it died, but we had a good time. It was a good tryst I had with that truck.
Mm-hmm.
So I can't afford to keep up with a 30-year-old vehicle. No. 40-year-old vehicle.
Yeah, that's a lot. That's a lot of expense.
So right now, Jimmy is actually in a cube about 3 by 3 foot at a landfill in Muhlenberg, scrapyard.
Oh, God. Well, that's what happens. Nothing lasts forever. True.
This is one of the older pieces. Well, older meaning like maybe 3 or 4 years
mm-hmm.
old. That's a painting of List Road, which is on Mount Penn. It's kind of on the back side of Mount Penn, facing mm-hmm. away from the city. And at the time, I drove up and down that road, taking my boys to daycare. And I always kind of admired how the light was hitting it in the morning when I dropped them off. And I wanted to do a painting of it, and
mm-hmm.
it was, yeah. I like that one a lot. It's on a very strange, skewed piece of wood, but, which made framing it really difficult because you didn't know which way was up, which was down, but.
Right. Yeah, but I like that. Those are oils, right?
It's probably a mix of oil and an acrylic and probably some other mystery.
mystery
ingredient.
Mystery material,
there
yeah.
There seems to be some sort of oil mm-hmm. slick on it. But yeah, that I took that when it was still hanging up in my studio on that chain.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, if you buy it, it's actually framed and not hanging on a planter chain.
mm-hmm. I actually knew a guy who would mix his paints with salad oil.
Really?
Yeah.
I like that.
It worked for him. But
salad oil.
Yeah, like canola or sunflower or something like that.
Yeah, that would work.
Yeah, it would work. It's an oil, you know. And, but yeah, and it smells a lot different than turpentine.
Yeah.
Or any of those other solvents.
Yeah,
you
can't huff salad oil, I don't think.
No. Yeah, you could, you know, and if you get it on your fingers, it's not going to stain.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just lick it off.
Yeah. Oh. So. Now this is interesting. I like this. This reminds me of the coins for the Chinese prediction coins,
I don't know.
Yeah.
Yeah. There's definitely something antiquated about it, and it's like some sort of extraction from a cave painting or something like that. I don't know what that piece of, that's actually metal that it's on, but
mm-hmm.
I don't know what it was, but yeah, it made for a good substrate to paint on.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what the two characters are necessarily doing. It's like, you know, it looks like one guy's about to fall on the other, but
yeah,
I don't know. This one's always perplexed me. I look at it, I walk past it every morning when I go to my kitchen.
Mm-hmm.
And I even say to myself, what the heck is that about?
But you painted it, yeah. I'm like that too with this. I mean, it is an intriguing piece because you don't have any entry point, you know? Or that the entry point is cloudy.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that when you look at it, it's kind of like all the meaning of the image, all of the you know, anything referential is not there. And so it's the only thing that's referential is that little square hole in the bottom of it, which
yeah, I that's the one thing that is always the biggest challenge with working with found objects, be it wood or metal, and you know, you don't have this perfect rectangle or square or something like that, you know, that you'd buy at, you know, the arts and crafts store, and you know, you just kind of you know, you're kind of used to working compositionally within a square and a rectangle, and you've done it so many times that it's a great challenge. Like, you know, it's like, well, what do I do with this circle with a weird square hole in the middle of it, and or, you know, a piece of wood that's going this way or that way?
Mm-hmm.
Kind of just...
If you think about it in a different way, you could see it as having a relationship to the to a hex sign, you know, or Disselfink or something.
Yeah.
You know, how that's sort of like the design of a Disselfink kind of like folds into itself, where you have the two birds,
yeah,
you know, that are circling the center of the hex. But this seems to be doing the same thing, but in a different fashion. It's like there's all this, the references that you do pick up off of it is the rust, the age, the corrosion, the spin. You know, that sometimes it has to me it may say something about the fragility of living, or the ravages of time, you know, on the human being, you know. And it seems like it all kinds of cycles around that sort of thing. But, you know, when you paint and work like that, it's like subconscious. You're not really thinking about exactly what you're saying.
Yeah.
It's just coming out.
Yeah, it's fun working on something that's essentially a piece of history, you know, like, you know, mm-hmm. that thing, whatever that round thing served some sort of greater purpose to someone or something at some point in the past century or so. And, you know, as an object itself, before I, you know, threw paint on it, you know, it was really interesting. And I wanted to add another layer of mystery to it. And,
well, that does.
I don't know if I ruined the object or if I, you know, heightened it or not. I don't know.
No, I think you blended something into it. I think you fused an idea with a weathered object, an object that has lived a pretty good life already, you know. So I think it's an interesting piece. I really like this.
Thanks.
Yeah. Now, you don't do anything to clean these up at all, you know. I mean, when you get them, do you wash them? Do you scrub them down?
No. Yeah. If there's soil or something on top of it that I know will eventually by gravity or other force of nature fall off, I'll take it in the yard and hose it down,
mm-hmm.
or hose it down, as they
you
say.
Hose it down. Yeah.
But mm-hmm. yeah, I try to keep it as intact as I found it.
Mm-hmm. Well,
and sometimes if I'm working with metal, you know, you get a lot of sharp edges, and sometimes I have to kind of either fold over some of the edges because it might have cut me. I'm covered in cuts from a lot of the stuff that I do, but, you know, I try to, if I have to dull it down a little bit, I'll do that.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe we should call this my tetanus phase. You know, not Picasso had his blue phase. This is my tetanus phase.
That's funny. So now what is this one?
Yeah, that's that little guy. This was actually on cardboard. I was salvaging a lot of cardboard from my work in other places and using that as a something to paint on. And that guy is essentially just... I think it's like an oil-based primer, and there's actually a little bit of roofing tar in there. And I think I think I mixed in a little bit of wood stain with something in there to kind of vault the color forward. You know, this is in the scheme of everything else that we've been looking at, this is relatively old. I think this one's from 2 years ago. And I think it was at this point I was realizing, like, wow, well, I'm getting some neat effects here, but at this point I'm just kind of doing, what's it called?
Trompe l'oeil.
Trompe l'oeil. And I'm trying to create a surface that I eventually, you know, solved by just finding things that look like that, you know. Mm-hmm. I don't know. But yeah, I always like doing kind of black on white, very monotone looking stuff, kind of. Robert Motherwell's always been a hero of mine, and Franz Klein.
Mm-hmm. Well, I have a special fondness myself for materials like this. There's a certain a formal quality to it that, you know, if you had not had any sort of image in it, and if it was just all surface, even that as it is, I mean, there's a beauty to the surface, like some of the artists that paint abstractly and just use that kind of odd materials. It's some of it is just its mere presence has a power to it, and this
a lot of Anselm Kiefer's surfaces are so heavy and just beautiful. Like, you know, even a 1x1 inch portion of a 20-foot by 30-foot painting of his is beautiful. So that's definitely an influence.
Yeah, Kiefer's a real remarkable character. I saw his exhibit down in Philadelphia a number of years ago, and it just blew me away. The paintings themselves were just huge.
Yeah.
You know, they were massive. And then they had all kinds of stuff inside of them. There was a real big iron bar, you know, that was hanging in front of them, you know, in front of one with like straw, you know, all covering the whole thing.
Yeah.
You know, that sort of stuff really has a power to it. And I think this is somewhere in that realm. You know?
Yeah, I kind of like, you know, when it does come to the imagery, I want it to have a gravity of some sort, but you don't know where that gravity is coming from.
Right.
And it's just, again, the mystery, I guess.
The mystery. Which?
That one cut me a whole lot.
Oh, my. Look at that. Is it?
I don't know what that was. I don't know what the material was, or the painting, but I think it sold. Somebody bought it. But yeah, it's a kind of a strange bird type thing. I remember I did that very late one night. I think I was just wearing my pajamas. But
that's really.
Yeah, it's really, really fragile. I remember that. It's really very light metal, flaky stuff. But yeah, I kind of like these strange, unidentifiable creatures. Mm-hmm. I think I was channeling Matt Deterrier and his little birds at this point.
Oh, yeah, Matt.
His little hatchlings, they've always fascinated me.
So I mean, but I saw Matt's stuff down at Lewis Long Gallery.
Yeah.
And he's doing all these devils and fanged skulls and things like that. I mean, I'm going into the grotesque again.
But, that's okay.
Vermin.
That was always one of my favorite words that, like, my dad and my uncle used a lot to describe any kind of unwelcome animal. It's like, it's just a vermin.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's also the word that they use for any kind of roadkill. It's like, oh, someone got that vermin. So I don't know. I wanted to kind of cage that word, and I kind of sort of turned that happened. Mm-hmm. I wanted the word up there because it's such a strange word. I don't know what the context is, or, you know, I guess it's a noun, but it's like, what is a vermin? Like, is there actually an Oxford Dictionary definition of that word? There probably is, but...
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there is.
But,
I
think that, this was all about caging that word and giving it a life of some sort without being very specific about any kind of vermin. I think I tried painting some sort of animal in it, but the fact that you can't really tell what it is.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's that white.
Gives it success. Yeah, that's kind of white and pink. Mm-hmm. It's like a skinned goat or something, but.
Mm-hmm. Well, actually, vermin would be like a rat or, you know, some sort of garbage eating, you know, filthy.
Is a cinnamon varmint?
Varmint. I think that's a degradation of that word. I think varmint is like slang.
I don't know.
Yeah. But it's fun. Yeah, it's a pop. I think of Yosemite Sam, you know, varmint.
Yeah.
Varmint.
That's right.
Yeah, varmint. So, go to the next one here. That's a photograph.
Oh, yeah. That one. That's a multimedia, mixed media piece. It has a photograph mounted on a kind of a piece of aluminum. I think it was actually from a piece of luggage that I found somewhere. And I cut it up, and I had this photograph of a bed, and I wanted to kind of make a small story about it. Mm-hmm. And underneath it, and I don't know if you can read it at home, it says, "The devil made me do it the first time," which was actually a country song. But I always liked the title a whole lot.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, I think I knew the title of the song before I knew the song itself. And I was like, wow, I don't know what the song sounds like, but I think that there's sort of a strange mortal sin quality to the piece, but, you know, mm-hmm. being this kind of dirty monument to to something. Mm-hmm. You know, something happened on that bed, and somehow someone bad or something bad was involved with it.
Well, it's also inferring, too, that if the devil made you do it the first time, you don't claim responsibility. But
that's right.
The next time, it's your own doing. It's your own fault.
That's right.
So, you know, it's...
So something happened after this. So
that...
The first time. Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, there's sort of a moral plate going on in there.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's kind of neat, though, because it's like... See, this is the kind of way that it involves the viewer. You know, it's not like a... It's not... You don't have, like, passive viewing here.
Yeah.
I mean, everything that you're looking at has a direct confrontational approach. So that when you're looking at one of your artworks, you get this feeling that there's more to this than meets the eye.
Yeah.
And that it's you know, and that the materials themselves are saying something.
I'd like to think that. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So I mean, that's what I think. You know, from my limited understanding of things.
Yeah, and strangely enough, like this is one of the scarier pieces I've made. My father bought this one, so he's going to have that in his house. So it's odd. It's very odd. I'm glad that he has an appreciation. I think I got a lot of my kind of sinister humor from my dad.
Yeah, I like your humor. I think that's what I think that that's a lot of what powers this. I mean, in many ways too. There's a whole school of thought surrounding this. I mean, because Peter Snyder is in the same, it's in the same boat, because he uses humor in his work as well too. So and also decrepit materials, but this seems to be more, you know, like compact and more
concentrated.
Concentrated, you know. It's like tied, you know, throw it in a washer.
Yeah.
Yeah. So.
Uh-oh.
Uh-oh. What are we, are we contemplating our male and female identities here?
It's okay. It's really just paint, so it's really not anything. But I'm not sure. It's kind of this... neutral creature,
yeah.
That's kind of, I don't know, kind of looks like he's either doing the sit-ups or about to like puke on himself or something like that. But
yeah.
But I my figural work is always distorted as you know, going back to even, you know, in college when they had models come in, I always wound up distorting people on purpose because I don't know, I just got bored with just trying to capture, you know, I didn't want it just to be representational or duplicate of what I'm looking at. It's like, you know, the model could have, you know, maybe just asking to have a stump instead of a head.
Yeah.
So right. I don't know. I just kind of like the fact that this is kind of this gender neutral kind of, it's not really sexy at all, but it's filthy.
It seems to have some sort of reference to sex and, you know, in consideration of your own identity as a sexual being.
Yeah.
You know, and that seems to say a lot in that. I mean, I think this is an important work.
I was going to actually write the words "pretty fly for a white guy" on it, but that would have just given away too much. So.
Yeah.
Oh, which is a song, in case you don't know.
I could see this 20 foot long.
20 foot long.
Yeah.
Yeah, that could be. Yeah, like a.
That could be.
Yeah, this one's only about 4 by 12, maybe.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, that'd be really fun.
Mm-hmm.
To do something on that scale.
Yeah, like that. That's pretty interesting. Now this one here, this is also on metal, right?
Yes. Yes, it is. Now, I just sold that one recently.
Oh, that's cool. It's like you got sent to the disciplinarian's office and you were supposed to write "something ain't right."
Yeah.
You know, 100 times on the chalkboard before.
Yeah, I kind of always, I liked this one a lot, and it went to a very good home that it can be appreciated, and,
mm-hmm.
you know, I like the idea of my work kind of coming off as something that somebody did on the floor of a sanitarium or something like that.
Yeah. That makes sense.
I like that. Yeah. I think that's a very nice compliment, you know, instead of, oh, mm-hmm. are you part of the Hudson New School, or, you know, or I don't even know what that means. You paint boats or something. I don't know. I used to know all that stuff, but
we have to.
I got old.
We have to give this a movement of that. They're calling stuff like this up in New York the new casualism.
New casualism.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, but where they're kind of like showing the backsides of canvases and, you know, just loose fabrics and things like that, you know, hanging off the walls, and it's kind of like just not distorting the image, but distorting the process.
Yeah,
and you know, like taking the whole idea of what you're making and the materialism of it, and turning it upside down or inside out, you know, to show the guts of it, you know, and that's kind of like what you're doing here, but
I think we need to have a Burke's casualist show.
That would be cool.
That'd be really.
That would be cool.
We get it sponsored by like Kugel's Recycling or something like that.
Yeah. Yeah. And get one of those the trash collectors that donate money. You know, like they'll do that. Yeah, but this is something ain't right. It's like saying something about your doubts, your questions, you know, about life or whatever. And it's on this piece of old, rusted, corroded metal. And it's, it seems like a piece of, almost like a piece of armor, like a shard, you know, of a knight's suit or something.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know. There's all kinds of references that you can pull from it, but you're not offering anything. It's like
no.
Yeah. It's just like no. This is what it is. Make out of it what you want. You know.
Choose your own adventure.
Choose your own adventure. Exactly. So.
We are welcoming home viewers tonight.
That is true. If you want to call, please do.
I'll just lie through my teeth to you.
Oh, yeah, we're good at that. So, New Arts Alive. I'm with Matt Mazurkiewicz, and give us a call, you know? But in any case, on to the next piece. Bang, bang.
Yeah, this is another one that ties into kind of a regional theme. I think it actually might have been a reaction to, like, there was a good length of time where it seemed like every day in the local paper there's been some sort of mass shooting, but just, you know, it's been a repeat thing, you know, it's mm-hmm. Reading and it's what happens, and I don't know, I just wanted something that kind of tied back to where we are and what's going on, you know. We kind of got this bloody red keystone there that's just this kind of got this odd monolithic quality about it, but it's also kind of delicious looking. And then you have these heavy words, bang bang, and I don't know.
Well, there's definite satire there, I think.
I think so too.
Yeah, very much. So we got. Let's see. Let's go on to the next one here. Go go go!
I tripped over this one this morning. That was. It was sitting on the floor. I must have moved it or something like that.
So that just looks like chalk, or
yeah, that was chalk and crayon, just on a piece of metal, and I just wanted a kid's toy kind of looking thing. I don't know. I think one of my twins, Dexter, asked me to do a picture of a toy. Mm-hmm. He didn't really specify what kind of toy. So I just kind of made up this weird bird cocoon with wheels coming out of its appendages.
Cool.
Am I okay to say appendages? Okay.
Yeah, appendages is okay.
But yeah, that was just that's the playful one. That's mm-hmm. the fun. That's the fun one. That's I don't know. That's what that is.
I just found out the other day that. You know, they've been loosening up the restrictions on language on certain television shows. So, like, if you watch, like, Suits or one of those others, they have they are allowed to say one particular word four times in the show, and that's it, you know. And the word is a curse word. Begins with S, you know what I'm talking about. And they're allowed to say it four times, but if they say it five times, no good.
Mm-mm. Really?
Not allowed to fly.
S. What could that be?
What could that be?
Sally Struthers?
Sally Struthers, yes indeed.
That's two words.
Nah, yeah. I was trying to think of some way I could tie it into Hillary Clinton, you know. No. And here's a map of the United States.
I just mailed that one down to North Carolina. A friend of mine bought that. Saw it within 5 minutes of being posted. He messaged me and said he wanted that.
Awesome.
So that's the United States of America right there.
Mm-hmm.
Sans Maine, because I couldn't really squeeze Maine on there. So that's the best I could do.
You know, I don't think that.
but yeah, that was on a chunk of tree stump that I found somewhere.
That's a tree stump. Wow. That's
actually a piece of tree stump. It's only like 2 inches thick. So. A shard, a tree shard.
Okay, now we're reaching the very end of the show here. So
here we go.
Let's put the
Old Glory.
Old Glory. So, what's next for you? What's going on?
I'm gonna keep doing what I'm doing, and. I'm still scavenging for stuff, so
mm-hmm.
I'm just gonna keep working. And maybe if someone wants to show some stuff, I'll show it in a pizza shop if you want. I don't mm-hmm. care. I'll yeah, show it in your basement.
Well, that's a possibility. We'll talk later.
All right.
Okay. We're just being given the goodbye signal. So, anyway.
Thanks for having me, Ron.
I thank you for being here. Thanks.
Thank you, America.
And absolutely. This is New Arts Alive with Matt Mazurkiewicz. And I'm Ron Schira. And what happened there, you know?
America stopped.
The state of America here. Can't even play our own national anthem.
No.
But anyway, thank you once again.
Thank you.
And thank you, audience, for joining us tonight. And we'll see you next time on New Arts Alive.
All right.
New Arts Alive is produced through Berks Community Television and can be seen live on the second Tuesday of each month at 5 p.m. Consult your local community cable service for live and repeat programming. For more information about the New Arts program and its consultation residencies of artists from the literary, visual, and performing arts, call 683-6440 or write New Arts Program, P.O. Box 82, Kutztown, PA 19530. Or visit the office and exhibition space at 173 West Main Street, Kutztown, PA.
Hours are Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, 1 to 5, Saturday, 10 to 2, or by appointment.
BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.